I would like to thank you, the organization DABMSA, for giving me an opportunity. And I was hoping to speak at the last because I thought by that time you will be tired, so that I can escape by speaking only for 5 minutes. I'm not a scholar. I'm not someone who is a speaker. And to talk about Ambedkar, or to talk about his philosophy, I don't feel that confidence in me to speak. What I can talk about is the experiences. They are my own experiences of caste discrimination and the work which I do. Before that, I will like to say that there are three books which actually I have read, and one is by Professor Aloysius, who is sitting here, and which actually gave me so much perspective to look into things. And when I was struggling with my own identity as an Indian, as a Dalit, as a North Indian, so I came across his book, Nationalism Without Nation. And so, you know, I'm very glad that he's with me, you know, he's sitting with us. And I will really like to thank him for that book, because this is one book, and another you know, professor from Hyderabad, Kanchalaya, Why I'm Not Hindu. This was the first book which I read when I came to JNU. And I'm someone who comes from a Dalit caste, which is one of the most Hinduized caste. And in my family, everyone is a practicing Hindu. And all of us have caste experiences. My father had caste experiences. My elder brother had caste experiences. But somehow, you know, and I come from UP, and I'm speaking about the time when BSP was there, when Mayawati became first time chief minister. So the political atmosphere was there, but that cultural aspect, that religious aspect, not many, you know, among Dalits were able to, you know, come out of that. And I belong to those, one of those families, and I can see that, you know, in my own parents, though they supported BSP, and they thought that they are, you know, very politically conscious, but still they will call Brahmins and do the puja and practice everything, you know, almost everything. So when I came to JNU after my own experience of engineering college, where for the first time I was born in a semi-urban area. My father was a lawyer, and coming from a caste which is not so discriminated vis-a-vis the other Dalit castes like Balmikis or Chamars, I had a very safe and protected upbringing. And something which I was aware of caste. It is not that we are not aware of everything. We were aware of caste in the schools, in the playgrounds, but it never hit me that much. But when I came to engineering college, the first day, you know, the moment you go and take your admission forms, and you fill up the forms, and then you are asked that whether you are from a quota, you have to furnish your certificates. And those were the experience which are, you know, so scary for me, that I still remember those eyes, you know, those clerks who asked that caste certificate, the way they ask you, the way they talk to you, the way, you know, when your hostel is allotted, how your you know, in classroom, your roommates are selected. So everything, I was witnessing that, and it was shocking for me from the first day itself, the way, you know, ragging happened. You know, I'm talking about 1996. So at that time, ragging was, you know, very much prevalent, and now, thanks to Supreme Court and some activism, now ragging has come down. But the ragging, the way it was taken up, well, those times, you know, I can't even explain to you, this was so horrible. And the Dalit students and Adivasi students have to suffer double the amount of ragging. And the humiliation starts from the first day, you know, right? So you go, you fill up your form, and then you go to your room and in the night ragging starts. So it's such a scary experience. But then you think that these days, you know, because you are aware that these things happen, ragging happens, everybody knows, so you are prepared for that. What you are not prepared is how faculty deals with you. Because this is something which nobody told me, you know, not my parents told, not my, you know, anyone told me. And every, you know, and there is this feeling among the educated Dalits that once you leave village, things will change, things will improve. Caste, you know, this, with this hope we are brought up in our families. You know, I'm talking about, I'm a second generation literate, so I'm talking about that kind of family where there has, you know, earlier one generation which has education. I don't have much experience about the first generation literate. Maybe they are much more aware about how things work because they might not have that kind of protective environment which I had. So being from a second generation literate, we are being told that, okay, this is fine, you know, your friend does not come to your home, it's okay. Or, you know, you're not called to your friend's birthday, it's okay. But gradually you will move up, you will go to bigger cities, these things will not be there. You know, these things will not affect you. And this is how we are raised. We are raised almost in the denial. You know, now I can see that. Earlier I could never understand that, but now I can see that how in second generation literate families, you know, we are taught to live in denial about caste from our own families. And when we enter into these academic institutions, we are not prepared at all. We are not at all prepared about how, you know, you are going to face, because you believe that in 10 plus 2 you also scored 80% marks. You might be from a quota, but okay, fine, there is hardly 2-3% difference. I was doing an engineering and the branch which I chose, the topper of the branch was hardly 2-3% higher than me, which is, I don't think, you know, can be, you know, marker of the intelligence that he is 2-3% more intelligent than me. Of course, you know, even when you are a kid, you know that these numbers, it's okay, fine. It's for time being it affects you, but you know that you can always overcome. But what you are not prepared is that when you go, you know, from the first day itself, you are marked as a quota student. And not only quota student, you know, you are weak student. That the teacher from the first day, you know, itself, and your classmates and everyone, will start treating you as if you don't deserve to be here. You are not here, you are just here because of quota. And since we are not able to prevent those from you, prevent you from coming, we will make your life as much hell as possible. This is about 90s. I don't know, maybe things have changed, but this is what it is. And we are not prepared. You know, see, what I feel is that if somebody makes a casteist comment, and if I'm able to retaliate immediately with a counter comment, those casteist comments will not affect me that much. Right? Okay, fine, you will beat me physically, I will beat you next day. But what happens, the problem is that we are not able to counter those, you know, the daily comments, the bots, the questions which come. Okay, fine, you know, I have written about it, and, you know, that the first day itself, the teacher will make you stand up and, you know, to give your intro, and then they will ask you to tell your rank. So you have to tell your rank, and then rank, not only rank, you have to tell your category. I don't know why they want to ask, but they do ask. Then in VIVAs, if you're not able to, you know, answer, immediately they will ask you, are you from quota? So this one single comment, you know, me, it's so humiliating when you are in the class and somebody, you know, a professor, and the way we are brought up is that we look at teachers as some kind of god. So we our upbringing is like that, you know. Don't laugh, Prasanth. He's a professor now, and he's my classmate. He was my classmate in JNU. So we are being, you know, raised like that, and it really affects us morally. That small comments. And I've seen my students, my friends, suffering because of that. And these are the students who were toppers from their schools. And suddenly within first semester, their performance drops like anything. And there are backlogs, then, you know, and those backlogs keep carrying over. And after the year, you have 6-7 backlogs, and you are gone. And there is no support system. The teachers are not willing to, you know, help you, because they believe that you don't deserve to be here, and anyway you have come, and so it is not their responsibility to support. Then we have other practical problems, like most of us come from regional languages background. We come from, I was the only one in my batch. We were around 200 students, and there were some 30 total SEST students, and probably I was the only one who came from an English medium school. Rest 29 scheduled caste, scheduled tribe students were from villages, were from small towns, and were from regional languages. And you won't believe, all of them were, most of them were, have scored much higher than me in the entrance exam. Their ranks were much higher than me. Because in entrance exams, you can write in any language. So you can write in Hindi. You can write in, you know, your mother tongue, because there are facilities. But once you join these courses, you have to write in English. You have to read in English. And those students who scored much more than me, they failed. Whereas I passed. You know, and because, just because I knew English, just because that books which, you know, never scared me that much. Because I could read. But those students could not. And I saw that suffering, and, you know, and there was no support system whatsoever for the students. And then there was a lot of, you know, comments, and a lot of things were there. And so from then onwards, that, you know, it's a long story, and I will not tell you all the story, but the result was that I could not complete my degree. And I was thrown out because I protested, and I beat up the dean because of caste humiliation and everything. But I could not complete it. So that was, you know, that is the background from where I come. And then I decided that I have to work on this, because that was such an experience for me that, and the worst part is that you cannot explain these things to your own parents. My parents blamed me for this, that there are, you know, hundreds of students who graduate every year. Why only you? Why only you cannot do? There are hundreds of Dalit students who graduate. And believe me, I was not able to explain them at all. Because they were also in the denial mode, because they don't want to listen that there is a caste discrimination. But they know it. After some time, you know, after years, when my father was about to, you know, was very sick, and he was a cancer patient, and we had a talk, he told me. You know, because that was something which was very shocking for me, because my own parents are not willing to believe that there is something called caste. And what my parents used to say was that whatever used to happen, you should have adjusted with it, and you should not have left the course, or you should not have done those things which you did, and life would have been better. There have been means job, everything would be there. So that was a very difficult phase for me, because I was not aware about anything. You know, I didn't know how it is operating, how caste is operating. But I was 3 years I was there in engineering college, and I tried to organize students, did a lot of things I tried to do, but we could not manage, and we failed. But still, I was not able to understand that hatred. You know, why, you know, such hatred? The moment we come, why we generate so much hatred in the other? No. Why in the mess when we are sitting, so these Bhumihar, there is a caste in Bihar, Bhumihar, which is one of the most feudal caste in India. And unfortunately, my college, which was one of the oldest in India, was dominated by this caste. So the faculties were also Bhumihar, majority of them, and the students were also there. So there was a complete monopoly of those, you know, and the way they treated our students, you know, openly they will abuse. If we were sitting in a mess quietly eating our food, they will come and, you know, take away, snatch our foods. So I was not able to understand why this is happening. Because I always believed that I am like them only. I always believed that, I never saw any difference between me and them. But I could not, and I came out, and that was the time when I, I was lost, completely lost. I don't know what to do. So I joined my BA private because I already lost 3 years. So I joined my BA private, and there was a library there, a public library, and I was a sciences student before, so I was not in much in reading habit. So I thought I let me develop the reading habit, and I started visiting this library, and luckily I got this book called the biography of Dr. Ambedkar by Dhananjay Kir. That was the first book which I read from cover to cover, and that really, I think that was one of the moment where I found what I want to do in life, what and some answers which I was seeking in engineering college, I got from that book, and that was the first time when I was introduced to Baba Sahab. And it was really shocking for me, because whatever we knew about Baba Sahab was so little. I never heard about Mahar Satyagraha. I had never heard about all his fights apart from, his making of constitution, Indian constitution. And also the way BSP was projecting Baba Sahab. So we have heard about them. But somehow we are not able to connect with that, because your caste also operates. So in my caste, not many people were Ambedkarite. So from that my own social circle also, I could never derive that. Now I can see that. That time I could not realize, but when I look back, I can, realize that. So after that I came and joined JNU, and from there, the two books which I mentioned, and these are the only three books which I have read, actually, honestly speaking. I'm not a very well-read man. And since then I have been working on especially on discrimination. So I came here to Hyderabad and met DABMSA guys and Ravi, and because there is an issue here, there are students who have been rusticated from the school of German studies, and the data which we have is really shocking, that in last 5 years not even a single Adivasi student has been able to graduate, and there is only one Dalit girl which has been able to graduate after spending 2 more years, more than the stipulated time. And there has been 60 to 70% dropout rate. I can bet this much dropout rate will not be here anywhere in the world. And the most shocking thing is that the professors justify it, that these students are weak, they are weak, they don't deserve to be here, and they will say in the class, outside the class, and they will make you feel that you are inferior. And what the truth is, that I have all the data, I sat with Siramalu and Maya and Ranjan, all the students. I was here for 3-4 days, first week of this month, and I did a small, bit of research. And all these students are either first generation literate or second generation literate, and from very humble background. All 17 students are from very, very humble background, and all 17 are from non-English background. And all 17 are from rural areas, from Bihar, from Tamil Nadu, from Andhra, and from UP. And here they come after 10 plus 2, and all of them are above 60% percenters, yani first divisioners. And suddenly you tell them that you are not fit to learn a foreign language. A language, forget about foreign. Every language is a foreign other than your mother tongue. So, you are constantly told that you are not fit to learn a language. And after spending 3 years or 4 years, in Maya's case, she has spent 5 years, this is fifth year, and she is going without a degree, without a graduate degree. She has left with just one paper she could not clear. And when you raise your voice, then my friend, you know, and he's sitting here, they get a legal notice of defamation. And the first paragraph which says that Madam so-and-so, it belongs to such an illustrious family whose father was ex-governor and ex-chief justice, and mother was a reputed doctor. So against such professor, how dare you can say that she can be a casteist? So, you know, I laugh at it because it is, you know, it doesn't even shock me now. Because almost like 10 years, I've seen dead bodies of students. I've seen so much that it doesn't shock me. It just makes me to laugh a bit. And so, friends, we have been trying to, you know, fight this case. And I was in Marathwada and I got an SMS from Mohan that I have to speak. I was not willing to come because I think that the most important was that because we are conversing in all these areas, and I was like in last 3 days I was in Marathwada in Latur and Aurangabad and Nanded. So we are trying to mobilize the students to attack EFLU, you know, to come and sit here and don't leave till the justice is done. Because I believe that the academia is one of the most strongest hold of Brahmanism in this country, and which actually perpetuate the Brahmanism. You know, and my dream is, if ever I will be able to do, is to do a PhD on the topic that on how in last 60 years, it is the academicians, the theoreticians, the intellectuals, which actually ruined this, you know, country. Because when there was an independence, you know, movement, there was a space, there was a liberal space available. The political class was willing to talk about caste. The political class was, you know, an intellectual class was willing to look into all these problems. But after independence, what these academicians have done is that they have created a culture of denial on caste. They will talk about class, they will talk about all the stuff, and thanks to professors like Aloysius and Kanchalaya, now we have got an opening. Believe me, because of these professors only we have got that opening, that now no, they cannot say. So now they will talk about all those rubbish, like what Ashish Nandi and Aditya Nigam and those companies say, and now they say that you have monopolized Ambedkar. We were always, you know, talking about Ambedkar. We were always ready to interpret Ambedkar, but Dalits have monopolized Ambedkar. But I really, you know, and I joined JNU in 2001, and till 2001, you know, not many professors used to talk about Ambedkar. and only the Dalit students used to organize seminars. So then only you can, you know, hear about Ambedkar, caste. After so much, you know, struggle, we have been able to talk about this. And I don't want that this speech, which we have been able to create because of our own autonomous politics and because of our own academicians, we need to hold on this space and then attack this. I was also thinking that I will read out my pamphlet, but I will not. You will, you know, I'm going to upload it today, tonight on roundtable. So you, this pamphlet is about EFLU only, and the kind of activities, the kind, next 2 months we are planning protests across the country in different, you know, cities, and then in second week of July, coming in numbers like 5,000, 6,000 people coming here and marching in this campus. So this is what, I don't know how much we will be able to achieve, but this is a try I really want to give. And academia and the university spaces is one which I really love to hate. Thank you very much.